From Byfleet to the Bush, an autobiography by Jacqueline Pearce. Chapter 1, Byfleet. I loved my life in Byfleet. No, I didn't. I loved Byfleet, not the life I lived there. I was born in Woking, Surrey on December 20th, 1943, and brought home to Queen's Avenue in Byfleet, which in those days was a small country village. Our avenue was lined with chestnut trees, so my parents, who were not known for their originality, named the house Chestnuts, and there I remained for the first 17 years of my life. My mother didn't, but more about that later. At the bottom of our garden was a large field, in the centre of which was a perfectly manicured, emerald-green cricket pitch, where men dressed in pristine whites would play on drowsy Sunday afternoons. I loved the cricket field. In summer, it would be carpeted with celandines, buttercups and daisies, which I would weave into chains and place on my head and around my neck. All the houses on our side of the avenue had gardens, with gates at the bottom that opened onto the field, enabling neighbours to chat together and children to play. Cowboys and Indians was a great favourite, but being the only girl in my peer group, I was always the lone Indian, captured and bound to a tree, while Anthony Wand, Jeremy Bean and John Bragg fired my arrows at me. I still have a small scar on my right eyebrow, a reminder of the time when Ant got lucky. In order to gain admission into their gang, I had to squeeze a bunch of stinging nettles and not make any sound at all. In the autumn, we played in the avenue as the chestnut trees filled the street with russet-coloured leaves in which we could hide and roll around, flinging great armfuls at each other, and shed huge, shiny conkers which we threaded onto lengths of string and had glorious conker fights. When I look back on my childhood, I am very aware of the comfort I received from nature and the feel of the late 1940s and early 50s. I can still recall the scents of clover and huge red roses, their velvety petals heavy with morning dew, wild narcissi, bluebells and lily of the valley, the aroma of burning leaves and wood smoke as the melancholy of autumn hovered in the still air. My favourite season was and remains winter, Jack Frost leaving intricate patterns on the inside of my bedroom window, sheets frozen on the washing line as dusk descended, snowmen with coal noses and clay pipes, whose jolly daytime demeanour became slightly sinister as night began to fall. More than anything, I loved snow, its ability to transform all that was familiar into a fairy tale world of magic, mystery, and overwhelming beauty. I came home from school one December afternoon. It was dusk, and had snowed heavily all day. I ran down the garden to the cricket field, pushed open the gate, and entered a magic world. A blood-red sun was setting in a darkening sky. The bare branches of the trees were rimmed with silver frost. The cricket pavilion, now the palace of the Snow Queen, and the snow before me still in its virgin state. I wanted to stay in that world of beauty forever. I raised my four-year-old arms to the setting sun and ran towards it. I believed I could fly, that I was part of all that surrounded me, protected me, and claimed me as its own. I loved sweets, and when rationing finally ended in the mid-50s, I feasted on Rolos, Maltesers, Mars bars and Smarties. I haunted the sweet shops in the village with their large glass jars containing lemonade powder, a great favourite, sticky black and white striped bullseyes, treacle toffees, pear drops and Everton mints. I loved the dark interiors of the shops, each with its own smells and character. Lucas's was our nearest grocery shop. A brass bell rang as the door was opened, and counters lined three sides of its large interior. On the left was the slicer, where bacon, ham and gammon were sliced. On the right, the cheese cutter, where delicious crumbly cheddar was cut with a wire before being wrapped in greaseproof paper and popped into a brown paper bag. Mrs. Lucas at the counter in the centre sold broken biscuits for a penny per quarter pound and was very popular with the village children. So all in all, I had a great affection for bucolic Byfleet. I suppose now I should explain why I didn't like the life I lived there. For the first 6 months of my life, our house was occupied by my parents, Reginald and Stella Pearce, and myself. In June of 1944, in an attempt to make some much-needed extra money, my father advertised the front room and a bedroom for rent. My father was exempt from war service due to his employment at Vickers Armstrong, a factory involved with the manufacturing of aircraft, although I understand he did some sterling work in the Home Guard. His advertisement was answered by a young woman in her 20s, May Wilcox, whose husband George was in the Navy. She accepted the rooms, moved in, and was joined on his occasional spells of home leave by George. So the house now contained two families, the Pierces and the Wilcoxes. 10 months later, my mother, having decided that domesticity was not for her, left my father and myself in search of more exciting pastures. After discussion with May, a decision was reached. When the war ended, she and George would both live with us, she as housekeeper and substitute mother, he to continue his pre-war work in some clerical capacity, also at Vickers Armstrong. George would also become my legal guardian in the event of my father's demise. So they assumed the roles of foster parents. I called May mother, her husband uncle, and my father father. The loss of my mother at the age of 16 months was the defining moment of my life. It has informed everything I have been and become. Its influence might have become less intense in later life had I successfully bonded with May. The insecurity I experienced might not have been as chronic. Just before my third birthday, I was sent to stay with my father's sister, Auntie Wynne, and her husband, Uncle Fred, in Upminster, Essex. I loved staying with Auntie Wynne. She had one child herself, my cousin Peter, who, being 10 years older, occupied a different planet. Auntie Wynne loved having a little girl around and spent hours twisting my long, dark brown hair around strips of rag, which would result in ringlets when she removed them the following morning. The love, kindness and attention that Auntie Wynne showed me during those difficult early years is something I have never forgotten. When I returned to Byfleet, having spent Christmas and my third birthday in Upminster, it was to discover that May and George had had their own child, a daughter called Maxine, her impending birth being the reason for my stay in Upminster. No one had told me that this was on the cards. I simply arrived home to find that I had lost my substitute mother to her own child. So by the age of 3, I had lost not only my birth mother, but also my substitute mother, and had a highly unorthodox home life, quite unlike that of any of my contemporaries. My father was an extremely strict parent. I was born left-handed, which I was forced to change. Much later in life, I discovered that this was because my birth mother was also left-handed, and my father wanted no evidence of her in me at all. So terrified was he that I would resemble my mother in later life, that he held on very tightly to his own idea of who he wanted me to become. As an adult, I grew to understand that whatever else he wanted me to be, he didn't want me to be in any way a sexual being. And by sending me to a convent, he very nearly obtained his wish. I think he found my mother's sexuality threatening and believed at some level that his inability to satisfy her sexually was a large factor in her decision to leave him. Many years later, a meeting with my half-sister, conceived 3 years after my mother left my father, provided me with information that allowed me to fill in a few of the many missing pieces to that particular puzzle. For the first 15 years of her life, Patricia, my half-sister, lived with our mother before she once again left hearth and home for greener pastures, never to be seen again. Our mother, it seems, was an enigma, a fantasist and compulsive liar, given to changing her name and her hair colour on a weekly basis, a drama queen par excellence, and with eyes that apparently had no soul. But the information I found most extraordinary was the discovery that my mother was a pure-blooded Romany gypsy. This explained so much about myself that had previously been inexplicable. My ideal home has always been a Romany caravan with an ensuite bathroom. My mother's family were not travellers, but lived in a settled community in the East End of London, which still, I understand, exists today. Patricia had many memories of going to stay with our Aunt Britannia, our mother's sister, who lived in a traditional Romany caravan, decorated in rich reds, blues and gold, and with an abundance of velvet cushions and brocaded curtains. My own capacity for transforming any home I have lived in into a Romany caravan is legendary among my friends. My mother's talent for drama was another genetic inheritance. I only met her twice. As a child, I'd had a dream that my mother would pass by a theatre, see my photograph outside, find me, and we would live together happily ever after. The first three parts of the dream came true, but the final one eluded me. When I finally met her at the age of 33, it was to discover that we had no common ground. There was nothing to suggest we were connected, and that her intention was to exploit me financially. My relationship with my father contained a strong element of sexuality, albeit unconscious. Ours was not a large house, so when members of the Pearce family arrived to stay for Christmas, my father would vacate his double bed for the duration and sleep with me on my single-sized horsehair mattress. Two warm bodies connected by blood drew great comfort, each in his or her own way, from the enforced intimacy of a single bed. I longed to have this warmth with my father forever, to have him exclusively for myself, to stay in this cocoon of togetherness for all eternity. Oh, Daddy, 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 love me, love me. Love me. I understand that any sexual feelings my father harboured for me were not in fact an indication of paedophilia or of any intent to turn desire into deed. But he was in no way equipped to deal with sexual feelings towards his own daughter, particularly when she was only 7 years old. He was far too intellectually impoverished to understand and was appalled by his feelings for me. This explains the many times he hit me, unable to accept that he had what he considered to be completely inappropriate feelings for his daughter. He transferred his disapproval of himself onto me and tried to beat it out of me. As a young teenager, I once left a used sanitary towel in the bathroom. It was wrapped and ready to be disposed of in the kitchen boiler, but I'd forgotten to take it with me, and it was discovered by my father. So great was his anger that he took me into the garden and hit me. I often wondered what had provoked this rage, which seemed out of proportion to my offence. According to the psychiatrist I discussed it with later in life, what my father was trying to beat out of me was the evidence of my burgeoning sexual maturity. He wanted me to remain his little girl. When I was 11, George was diagnosed with tuberculosis and spent a year in a sanatorium as a result. It was during his absence that I became aware of the relationship between May and my father. One night I went downstairs for a glass of water, heard sounds coming from the lounge, opened the door and discovered them in flagrante delicto. The discovery was never mentioned, nor the time I met her coming out of my father's bedroom, clad in nothing but some rather fetching underwear. I realised then that they were more than just good friends. My father was a much better provider than George, which enabled him to give me elocution, tennis and swimming lessons. May, of course, wanted the same for Maxine, but George was unable to come up with the readies. So she became jealous of me, as well as pissed off with him. During my mid-teens, I started to show evidence of my mental turmoil. When my father failed to appear for his tea one day, I asked May where he was. In a state of extreme anger, she told me he had gone off with Vi, the barmaid who worked in the Queen's Head, and she had no idea when or if he would return. In the event, he remained absent for 2 weeks, and the night he returned, I was in bed. He came into my room and gave me a box of chocolates. I hurled them through the open window and screamed at him, "I don't want chocolates, I want you!" I then began to keek like an animal, my terror of losing my lone parents so great that I was oblivious to anything else. My anger, fear, and isolation engulfed me and spewed out of me like the demons they were. I have great compassion for my father. He punished both of us endlessly for his perceived crime and suffered greatly as a result. But it did leave me with enormous sexual problems. During my first marriage, on the few occasions when intercourse was attempted, the image of my father that always appeared in the top left-hand corner of my mind was definitely a passion killer. Sex was forever associated with my father, and not having the insight I have since accrued, at the time I experienced this as a terrifying perversion. How could I possibly equate sex with my father? This was wholly unacceptable, a crime against nature. My sexual responses were nil. I found the act itself extremely painful. I was a tad tense, which could, of course, explain that. And the combined influences of paternal and religious guilt were to torment me for many years to come. What tangled webs we weave. To add to the confused relationship I had with my father, George also presented me with problems. One evening when I was about 14, May and my father had gone to a Masonic dinner in London, and George and I were washing up the tea things in the kitchen. Suddenly he said to me, "Do you know what a French kiss is?" I nodded my head, surprised by the question, as sex was never mentioned in our household. "Would you like to give me one?" was his next question. I shook my head vehemently and left the room. George used to wake me early in the morning so I could reluctantly crawl from the warmth of my bed in time to do my paper round. One morning I lay awake with my eyes still closed when I heard him enter the room. He didn't immediately wake me, but instead went to the end of the bed, where the clothes I had worn the previous day lay in a tangled heap. He sorted through them, picked out my knickers, and smelt them. I never let him know that I had witnessed this, and it happened again and again. One evening when I was taking a bath, Angie, my best friend, was in the bathroom with me. Angie used to sit on the loo and idly open and shut the door to the attic, which connected May and George's room to the bathroom. As she was doing so, she suddenly screamed and ran to the end of the bathroom. She had opened the attic door to discover George lying naked, watching me through a crack under the door, masturbating as he did so. He also used to give me letters, which supposedly had been written by a young boy with whom he shared an office. They went into great detail concerning the sexual fantasies he had about me, and both Ange and I knew that they had been written by George himself. By this time, I had a circle of male friends whom I met with Ange, usually in the Byfleet recreation ground, the rec. My first boyfriend was Arthur Luce, whose cornflower blue eyes and jet black hair attracted my attention. Of course, I wasn't allowed to have boyfriends, so elaborate subterfuge had to be employed. One night, I told my father I was going to visit a friend who was the daughter of the local policeman and so lived in the cop shop, and yes, I would be home by 8 o'clock. In fact, I met Arthur. We cycled up to Lover's Lane, as it was called, parked our bikes against an oak tree, and stole hand in hand into the wood and kissed. Nothing more, you understand. I was a good girl. I had just arrived back at the cop shop and turned my bike around when I met my father coming up the path. That was an extremely close shave, and I must have fancied Arthur rotten to have risked my father's ire in such a major way. The other boyfriend I remember was Robin Elkins, whose father owned a sweet shop in the village. I decided to leave home and left a note saying that I refused to return until I was treated like an adult. I packed a small suitcase and rode unsteadily on my bike to the rec. I told a friend that I had left home, and would he please go and get Rob for me so we could run away together? The friend duly delivered the message and returned with Rob's response, which was, "Could it wait until tomorrow night as I'm doing my English homework?" Then, to add insult to injury, Mr. Elkins phoned my father, who appeared at the rec to take me home in disgrace in front of all my mates. A bitter pill. I was the child of atheists who were strictly christening, marriage, and funeral churchgoers. I was baptized in the Protestant church, quite why I have no idea. Perhaps my father decided to keep my options open, and then dispatched to a Catholic convent for my schooling. I believe my father felt that the local primary school, the only other option, would not provide the manners and decorum that the convent assuredly would. His ambition was that I should be a lady above all else, and to this end I was sent, suitably suited and booted, to the Marist Convent, West Byfleet, at the beginning of the spring term in January 1948, a matter of a few weeks after my fourth birthday.